Amen. I promise I will not hold you very long today, or try not to anyway. Amen. Hear that loud book, amen. You watch it. I heard that. The Bible says in Exodus, I just set that up, but I'm sorry for taking forever to do that for you. Exodus chapter 10, beginning in verse number 1, the Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Go in unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I might show these my signs before him, that thou mayest tell in the ears of thy son and thy son's son what things I have wrought in Egypt, and my signs which I have done among them, that ye may know that I am the Lord." I want to talk today just about the question about why. Just why. And so when you go through a trial and you go through a test, one of the questions that always seems to be asked, or that we ask, and maybe not you, but at least I have asked, is the question why. Is anybody ever brave enough to say, yes, I've asked that before? You go through a trial and you say, why, God? Why am I going through this? What's the deal? What did I do wrong? Am I getting punished? By the way, it's good to have Brother Cain's niece from Athens with us. Is that right? Good to have you with us. Amen. Let's give her a hand for coming. Amen. Brother Baker's friend, good to have you again. Amen. Your daughters are beautiful. I got to drive them on the bus this week. Amen. Very well-behaved girls. So you're doing a great job with that. Amen. So we ask God the question why a lot. Why is this happening when things go wrong in our life? Why? What did I possibly have done wrong? Why is defined as a question concerning the cause or reason for which something is done. Something happens to you, we ask why. What is the cause or the reason for which this thing is done? And when you look at it, there's a few different things as to why something comes about. Most of the time, we focus on what did that person do wrong. When you go through a trial or you go through something and, you know, finances go wrong, health goes wrong, you know, so-and-so this happens, death happens, whatever, the first thing that we think of is what did they do wrong? Surely they've done something wrong. It's kind of like Jonah when he was on the boat going away from Nineveh. The storm came. What was the reason? Why were they in the midst of the storm? Because Jonah was running from God and running from his call. And so Jonah endangered everybody on the boat, and not just the people on the boat, but the entire city of Nineveh, who he was supposed to preach to, and not only the entire city of Nineveh, but the people that were expecting the supplies and the goods that were on the ship that they had to throw overboard because they thought they were going to drown. And so that's the first thing we think of. And then in the story of Jonah, they begin to cast lots. Who is the person? So they wheeling, you know, God works it out by casting lots, and it gets down to Jonah. Jonah's like, yeah, it's my fault. I'm running from God. Just throw me overboard. And most of you know the story of Jonah. And so it's because of Jonah's disobedience that brought a trial and that brought a test. But not every trial that we go through is because we did something wrong. Not every trial that you go through is because you messed up. Not every trial you go through is a punishment that God is dealing out to you because of some misstep or misfortune or misspeaking or misbehaving or not living right. It's what we always think of, but sometimes it has absolutely nothing to do with that. Sometimes God will do that in the case of Jonah, in the case of Moses, or the people within the 12 spies when they went out to survey the land. The Bible says that 2 came back with a good report, and that 10 came back with an evil report. And because of the evil report and them persuading the nation of Israel to follow them, saying that this land, we can't do it, there's giants, there's no way that we can overcome this. Because of their unbelief, that God made them wander in the wilderness for 40 years until everybody who was 20 years old and upward passed in the wilderness. And so there are times in our life that we are going to go through a hard time because of sin. There are times that we're going to go through a trial because of a misstep. We're going to have disease in our body because we have done something wrong. It's all throughout the Bible. But I want to look at a different angle at this. It's another reason why things happen to us. And if you read through the story of Israel, you read through the story of Moses and the exodus of the children of Israel, you'll find something that maybe you've noticed before, maybe you haven't. But if you go to Exodus chapter number 4, if you backtrack just a little bit from Exodus 10, go back a couple chapters to Exodus chapter 4 and verse number 19 through verse number 21, the Bible says, And the Lord said unto Moses in Midian, Go, return into Egypt, for all the men are dead which sought thy life. If you don't know the story of Moses, he grew up in the Pharaoh's court, and he was raised like a son of Pharaoh, but Moses realized who he was, and he was a Hebrew. He saw an Egyptian, beating a Hebrew slave, and Moses went up and attacked them because, you know what, you don't pick on family. And so he killed the Egyptian and hid his body in the sand, thinking that Moses had gotten away with it. But we know that there was another fight not too many days later, and the Hebrews were fighting, and Moses went to break it up, and they said, what are you going to do, kill me like you killed that Egyptian? And so now Moses ran for his life, and he was into the fields of Midian and went through the desert, ends up getting married. And in Exodus 3, he gets the call to go back and be the deliverer. Now we're in Exodus 4. He says, go to Egypt. So he went away from Egypt for a while. And if I'm not mistaken, he was gone for 40 years. And now he's getting ready to go back. And he says, for all the men who are dead which sought thy life. Verse number 20. Moses took his wife and his sons and set them upon an ass, and he returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. And the Lord said to Moses, when thou goest to return to Egypt, see that thou do all the wonders before Pharaoh which I have put in thine hand. But I will harden his heart that he shall not let the people go. So God tells him that you are going to return to Egypt. And you are going to do some mighty things. In Exodus chapter 3, you'll find that God tells Moses to take his staff and throw it on the ground, and it becomes a serpent. And then he says, pick it up by the tail. When he picked it up, it became a rod again. He told Moses, put your hand in your coat and pull your hand out. When he did, it was leprous. But when he put it back in, then it was back to normal skin. And God is telling him, you're going to do some mighty works in the land of Egypt. But he says, I will harden his heart, talking about Pharaoh, that he shall not let the people go. Moses takes his family and he goes back to Egypt. He makes the journey from Midian, crosses the desert, and goes back to Egypt and begins to tell Pharaoh the famous words, let my people go. And Pharaoh's response is not okay. It's not sure. Take them. It's not what he said. He said, who is your God? Or who is this God? Why should I let you go? He says, I don't know him, talking about God. I don't have to listen to his request. Since you have bothered me, he said, I'm going to make your people's life a little harder. He tells them, I'm going to take away the straw that they were using to make bricks. And now they're going to have to find the straw themselves instead of us bringing it to them. They're going to have to find their own straw. They're going to have to make the bricks. And not only that, they've got to make sure that they make the same amount of bricks as they did before. So if they had to make 1,000 bricks when we brought them straw, now they've got to go get their own straw and still make 1,000 bricks. And so everything in Moses' life begins to unravel. Because when you go to Pharaoh and you say, let my people go, let me tell you about God. And he goes and he throws his staff on the ground and it becomes a serpent. And the Pharaoh's magicians, they do the same thing. They throw their staff on the ground, it becomes a serpent. But the Bible says that his rod starts eating, or his serpent starts eating the magician's rod, and their serpents. And, you know, the plagues start to happen, turns the water into blood, and all these different things. But when the people of Israel get the word from the taskmasters that not only do you have to make bricks, but now you got to get your own straw, they don't like what they're hearing. They're already in bondage. They're already in slavery. They're already going through a trial and a test. And now they begin to tell Moses and complain to him, why don't you just kill us now? Well, what are you doing? Why are you here? Did you really even hear from God? Are you sure that God said to come and let my people go? Are you sure that you're a deliverer? Are you sure that you weren't just really tired that morning when you saw that bush that was on fire, as you say, in Mount Sinai? Are you sure that you were in your right mind when you heard that voice come out of that bush, or were you just kind of hearing things? Was it the wind blowing through the different parts of the mountain that made it sound like that? Are you really sure about what you say? They begin to despise Moses for being there. And Moses goes back in Exodus chapter number 5, if you would turn there, verses 22 and 23, and then chapter 6, verse number 1 and 2. Exodus 5, the end of the chapter, beginning of chapter 6. The Bible says, that Moses, after hearing the complaints of Israel, he returns to the Lord and said, "Lord, wherefore hast thou so evil entreated this people? Why is it that thou hast sent me?" Here it is. It's a why question. Why did you even send me here? Because from the time that I got here, everything's gone wrong. Pharaoh said, "No, I've turned the water into blood. That didn't do anything." And not only that, now Pharaoh's mad. And now there's more work for the children of Israel. Why did you even send me here? "For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he hath done evil to this people. Neither hast thou delivered thy people at all." Verse chapter 6, verse 1, the Lord said unto Moses, "Now thou shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh. For with a strong hand shall he let them go, and with a strong hand shall he drive them out of the land." And God spake unto Moses and said unto him, "I am the Lord." Moses asked the question, "Why did you bring me here? Why am I doing this? Was I brought here to bring more pain and hardship to your people?" But Moses forgot that God had already spoke to him and told him that he was going to harden Pharaoh's heart. We read it in Exodus chapter number 4 and verse number 21. At the end of it, he said, "But I will harden Pharaoh's heart. He will not let thy people go." God already told him, "Moses, you're going to go there. And Moses, you're going to do what I tell you to do. But Moses, I want you to understand that it's not going to happen in the way that you think it's going to happen. You're going to do a miracle, and I'm going to perform my wonders. But Pharaoh is going to say no, because I am going to harden Pharaoh's heart." Sometimes when we are in the middle of a trial, we forget what God has spoken to us in the first place. We forget that God has a plan through it all. Sometimes he reveals it to us, and sometimes he doesn't. But either way, we need to just trust in the Lord that God is doing it, and God is working it out in his way, in his plan. We need to understand that he is in all control. He's got it all under control. We may not know the why now, but God will always reveal the why in a later time. He may not have revealed the why, but he had already told Moses, "I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. There's something that's going to be done here. You just got to hang in there, Moses. You got to stick with this a little bit. I know it's painful, and I know, I mean, you got to think. One man coming back and saying he heard from God in front of a million or more people. You got to think that takes a lot of guts, number one. And number two, when it doesn't go your way, imagine, put yourself in Moses' shoes when a million people turn on you. And it's like a crazy mob, and they're coming for your life, and they're coming to kill you. Look at what I have to do now. Moses, you're not making bricks. Moses, you're not stomping in the mud pit. You're not getting the whip on your back. And so why did you even bother to come here? Think of the weight that is on Moses' mind. Think of the weight that is on his shoulders right now. The people that he loved, the people that he knew he was going to deliver are turning their back on him. He says, "God, why? Why am I going to do through this?" Exodus chapter number 7. Verses 1 through 5. The Bible says, "The Lord said unto Moses, See, I have made thee a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Thou shalt speak all that I command thee, and Aaron thy brother shall speak unto Pharaoh, that he send the children of Israel out of his land. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart." There it is again. "I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. But Pharaoh shall not hearken unto you." Why? Here it is. He begins to reveal something to Moses. "That I may lay my hand upon Egypt, and bring forth mine armies, and my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt by great judgments. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I stretch forth mine hand upon Egypt and bring out the children of Israel from among them." This is where God begins to give the why to Moses. He tells Moses, you're going to go do some great things. And you're going to tell them, "Let my people go." And you're going to do exactly what I tell you to do. But I want you to know that he tells him a second time, Pharaoh will not listen to you. And I'm going to tell you why this time, Moses. Because I'm going to leash out my armies, and I am going to let the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. But not just out of the to do it by some great judgments. And why did he do this? So the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. The Egyptians didn't believe in God. They believed in all these different gods, Anubis and all these other gods that they worship. They did not believe in the one true God, nor did Pharaoh even think of the power of the one true God. In fact, he thought that God just was equal to his gods, because everything Moses did, the Egyptians could do. And when he turned his rod into a serpent, the magicians could do that. When they did things like turning the water into blood, the Egyptians also mocked that. There was a few of the miracles that Moses did that the Egyptians could mock. But at this point, God said, go back and tell them, let my people go. He's going to say no, but I'm going to start to do something that they can't do. I'm going to do something that they cannot imitate. And I'm going to make sure that by the time this sucker's over, that they know who is the real God. That it's not Anubis, and it's not this God or that God, the cow or the elephant, but it is me. I am the one true God. So Moses, go back. Moses, you're going to have a hard time. Moses, you're going to get told no. Moses, the children of Israel are going to despise you, and they're going to hate you. And Moses, people are going to hurt you, and they're going to say bad things about you. But just hang in there, Moses, because I will bring them out, and I am going to make sure that thousands upon thousands of people know that I am the one true God. Because this thing was bigger than just Moses. Moses was bearing the weight of the child for millions of people. Why am I going through this? Moses, I'll tell you why. Because there are millions of people that don't believe that I am God. There are millions of people that don't believe that I am Jehovah, that I am the all in all. They don't believe that I have power. Israel almost gave up hope. They said, what's the point? Amen. God's probably forgotten about us. But God said, Moses, I need you. I trust you. You're strong enough. You can handle this. Remember what the Bible says, that in the trial that God will not put on us more than we can bear. And even in the midst of the trial, he'll always make a way of escape in case we decide that we cannot bear it. What God was trying to tell Moses is, I trust you, and you are cut out for this. You can do this. I appointed you for this hour and for this purpose. That's why you're here. That's why you're going through what you're going through. He tells him, look, I'm going to do this so I can lay my hand upon Egypt, and I can bring them out with great judgments. There are going to be times that your trial that you go through has absolutely nothing to do with you. The trial that Moses was going through had nothing to do with Moses. It had everything to do with the children of Israel and the Pharaoh and the Egyptians that he was going to. But sometimes it has to do with getting your family member saved. Sometimes you go through what you go through just so he can save a family member. Sometimes it has nothing to do with you. But God is about to prove that he is a provider to your co-workers. You haven't done anything wrong, but he may not be trying to get your attention. But God is trying to prove something to someone or get someone else's attention. You find in the book of Exodus that plague after plague, whether it be the frogs, the lice, the flies, the locusts, the boils, the darkness, the hail mixed with fire that fell from heaven, all of the different plagues that came their way. What did the Bible say about Pharaoh? God hardened Pharaoh's heart. And not only did they have to start making bricks to get their own straw, but then they said, you got to make even more bricks. And they upped their quota. And they put more afflictions on them. And they really beat them down and probably cut out their water breaks and their drink breaks, and trying to make it, you're going to get into that pit and you're going to work hard. And I'm sure Israel despised them. And they despised Moses. But God said, just hang in there, because I'm going to bring them out. Just hang in there, because I'll tell you what began to happen. As the plagues began to unfold, there came a time where it didn't affect the land of Goshen where the Israelites lived. God had a protective bubble around the land of Goshen. And so when darkness was in Egypt, there was light in the Israelite camp. When the animals were dying of boils in Egypt, the animals in Goshen, they weren't dying of boils. Amen. When the frogs were out and the locusts were out, they were everywhere in the land of Egypt, but in the land of Goshen, amen, God had his hand upon them. Hallelujah. I've come to tell you, you may be in the middle of a trial right now, and some, you may have just gotten started, and some, And think about a family member that might be blessed by your testimony. Think about a co-worker that might get touched by your testimony. Think about somebody that God might put in your path that he is trying to reach, and you might be going through the ringer, and you might be extended, and you might feel like giving up. Don't give up and don't quit, because someone's soul might be hanging in the balance. All you've got to do is hang on and understand the why of the trial. If you're going through the trial, realize that God may not be punishing you, but God trusts you enough to put that responsibility on you. He trusts you enough to say, I know you can handle this. Isn't that what he told Job? He trusted Job enough that when the enemy came in and the devil came in and said, look, I've gone to and fro. God said, have you considered my servant Job? Why did he even try? Why did he even say that to the devil? Why would he even allow the devil to tempt him? Because God trusted Job. He trusted Job that even though everything would be taken from him, he would still worship. And he did. And he trusted Job the second time when the devil came back. He said, take it, touch it. You haven't afflicted his body. And God said, touch his body, but you can't kill him. And boils come and this and that happened to Job. Why did God allow it? Because he was saying, I trust you, Job. I trust you that you're not going to give up. I trust you that you're not going to curse me. I trust you that you are going to live right. I trust you. And so why would you go through that? Because God trusts you enough to put that on you. He trusts you enough to say, you are stronger than you think you are. You're more powerful than you think you are. You can handle what I have put on you. Because if we believe the word of God and we trust God, he will not put on us more than we can bear. The Bible says that our faith is going to get tested. It is going to get tried. The trial of your faith being much more precious than the gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire. There's going to be trials. There is going to be tests. But when he does that, it's not that maybe you've done anything wrong, but maybe God's trying to prove something through you to somebody else. Because of Moses' steadfastness, because of his unwavering faith in God. And yes, he questioned it. We read it. Why did you bring me here? But he didn't run. He didn't turn away. He didn't say, God, the responsibility is too much. He said, God, I just need to know why. And God told him, this is why. Because I've got to do something. Because would Pharaoh have ever believed if he had never seen a miracle? Would the Egyptians never believe God? Would they have ever believed God if they didn't have one of their firstborn die that night of the Passover? But what got Pharaoh's attention when he lost his son, and all throughout the land of Egypt, everybody lost the firstborn son? It took mighty words to get them to go. But what happened, and I preached this New Year's Eve and that first Sunday when I wasn't sick, that we're not going to leave any man behind, that the Egyptians, when Pharaoh basically kicked the Israelites out, he said, just get out of here, take your animals, take your wives, take your children, take your junk, and get up out of here. I don't want you here anymore. And the Bible says that some of the Egyptians went with them. Some of the Egyptians were converted, and they believed because Moses allowed himself to go through the trial, because Moses allowed himself to be used of God. Acts chapter 16, verses 6 through 10. The Bible says, when they had gone throughout Phrygia, whatever, the region of Galatia, they were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. They were come to Mysia, I stayed to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. And passing by Mysia, they came to Troas. A vision appeared unto Paul in the night. Stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately he endeavored to go into Macedonia, assured the gathering that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel unto them. In Acts 16, we find this is about Paul and Silas. They're going around preaching the gospel to places that Paul had already been to. I'll give you a little background. In fact, the reason they were going around to these churches, they were supposed to talk to the Gentile churches regarding circumcision, and that they didn't have to go and be circumcised. There was people telling them, you must be circumcised or you can't be saved. The apostles got together and said, that's not so. And so they were telling them not to have division, but just keep going. And it tells them what they needed to do. And so one night, Paul has a vision of a man in Macedonia. And the man says, help us. Paul knew that he had to go to Macedonia to preach to him. And on their journey, Paul and Silas come across one that is possessed with a devil named Lydia. Paul, in Acts chapter 16, just a few verses down from what we read, Paul cast the devil out of her. Because of what they had just done, delivering this lady from demonic possession, the masters of Lydia took Paul and Silas and brought them before the magistrates. And they told the magistrates that Paul and Silas were troublemakers. That these are they that turn the world upside down. The troublemakers. They exceedingly trouble our city. They're disturbing us. Because of the accusation, Paul and Silas get beat and thrown into the inner prison. Their feet were fast in stocks, the Bible says. And Paul and Silas, while they're in jail, may have asked the question, why? Why am I in jail right now? Why am I going through this? Wasn't I supposed to preach to a man in Macedonia? Didn't I just have a vision of a man in Macedonia saying, help us? Why am I in jail? What did we do wrong? We just, somebody with demonic possessed, we cast the devil out. What's going on? Aren't we called to preach? Why, what did we do to deserve this? And we know that at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises to God. And we know suddenly there's a great earthquake and everyone's bands were loosed that was in that jail. And we love that part. We preach about it. I preach about it. We shout about it. We run the aisles. We spin from the lights. And it's awesome. We have a great time talking about it. But I'm going to tell you why Paul and Silas went through that. Acts 16:27-34. This is right after the shouting message. The next part. The keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep, seeing the prison doors open, drew out his sword, would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. He called for a light, sprang in, came trembling, fell down before Paul and Silas. He brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. They spake him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And they took them the same hour of the night, washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his straightway. And when he brought them into his house, he sat meat before them, and they rejoiced, believing in God with all his house. So why did Paul and Silas have to suffer? Because there was a jailer that needed salvation. There was a jailer that needed God. There was a household there that needed the gospel message. God knew the jailer was going to be in charge of the jail at that time. God knew that the only way the jailer was going to meet Paul and Silas was Paul and Silas had to go into his territory, had to go into the jail cell. They had to go to the place where he basically lived his life. He was the keeper of the jail. He was there. He was on call. He was there all the time. He knew that the jailer would only believe if he saw the miraculous power of Paul and Silas's God. God knew what it would take to reach just this one man and this one family. So he allowed Paul and Silas to go through the trial in order to reach just one man and to reach just one family. Can I tell you that he trusts you enough that he will let you go through a trial just to reach one soul or just to reach one family? He may put you through a trial just so you might save one person. And I tell you what, if you save one person by going through the trial, it is absolutely worth going through the trial. It's worth the heartache. It's worth the pain. It's worth the despair. It's worth the agony. It's worth the loneliness. It's worth being talked about and made fun of. Oh, if we could just see one person saved. So why are Paul and Silas in jail? Just so they could see one person saved and one family saved. You look at things like the lame man in Acts chapter 3 that was born lame from his youth, from his birth. He's lame. He said, think about this child. You can't walk for your entire life. He lays daily at the gate waiting for people to come by and toss some money because he's a beggar. He can't work for a living. He's going to have anything to eat. He's going to have any clothes to wear. He's going to live in a house. Wherever he lives, he's going to need some money. And so he was a professional beggar. He laid out there and asked an alms of every person that came in. But can I tell you that the trial that he endured for years of not being able to walk, and I don't remember how many years that he had this infirmity, just since his youth, and since the time of his birth. I don't know, maybe it says in there, maybe I just forgot how old this man was, but for years he would lay there, not being able to move his legs. For years he would lay there, day after day, waiting for people to toss him a few bucks here and there, just so he could get on with his life, wearing his beggar clothes. But the Bible says that Peter and John go into the temple, and they said, "Hey, I don't have silver and gold, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk." And the Bible says that immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength, and he picked up his bed, and the Bible says that he goes walking and leaping and praising God. And that's a great miracle, and we shout about that. But let me tell you what happens after the miracle. People say, "You can't preach in that name, you can't do this in that name, you can't operate in that name." But the Bible says that Peter and John and this man that can walk now, they said, "Look, God's done something for me. I can't help but speak the things that I have seen and the things that I have heard." And the Bible says that people saw this man walking and leaping and praising God, and they knew that it was the man that laid at the temple. You can read it in Acts chapter number 3. The Bible says they knew it was the man that laid daily. And what began to happen, thousands of people began to be converted. Why is a man born lame? It wasn't anything that he had done wrong, but God had a plan for his life. And it may not have come to fruition for 20, 30, or 40 years going through the trial. But I tell you what, it was worth it when he received strength in his feet and ankle bones, and people began to say, "How did this happen? What happened to you?" And he said, "I'll tell you what, some people came to me and they prayed in the name of Jesus Christ, amen, and Jesus healed me." And people began to talk about it, and people were baptized, and people were filled with the Holy Ghost. You might go through a trial for years and years and years, and you may never understand until the very end. And then God, boom, does a miracle. And all of a sudden, your eyes are open. "This is why I went through that. This is why I went through that sickness for so long. This is why I went through the frustration. This is why I had to endure what I endured." It had nothing to do with that man, but it had everything to do with every soul that was going to hear that testimony. It had everything to do with every person that heard that testimony and said, "I want to be committed to this God. I want to give my life to Jesus." And those people that were converted and baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost, that's what it was all about. This guy could have laid there and said, "What did I do wrong, God? What did I do wrong? Where have I failed you?" People have said that before. "Why? Where have I failed you? What have I done wrong? Why? Why? Why?" And sometimes, yes, we've done something wrong. Sometimes, yes, we deserve what comes our way. But sometimes it has absolutely nothing to do with you. God's just trusting you enough to reach a soul. He's trusting you enough to do something mighty in your life. You look at the life of Jesus. Jesus goes through the greatest trial of them all. Brother Spike, you want to come and play something? Close it over here. Okay. Jesus goes through the greatest trial of them all. Jesus did not do anything wrong. The Bible says that he was the Lamb. "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." If you know anything about the sacrifices of the Old Testament, the tabernacle, you couldn't just offer any lamb. But the lamb had to be what? Perfect. Without spot, without blemish, couldn't be lame, couldn't have a defective eye, couldn't be miscolored. It had to be a perfect lamb. Had to have the perfect muscle tone, had to have the perfect wool, perfect eyesight, good ears, no blemishes, no sickness, and it had to be perfect. Jesus Christ was the Lamb for us that atoned for our sins. Without the shedding of blood, the Bible says there is no remission of sins. In the Old Testament, they had to kill the lamb every year, roll back the sins. "I'm killing a lamb." They had to shed blood, a perfect lamb. But when Jesus Christ came, he became the perfect lamb for us. He was the lamb that was without blemish. The Bible talks about that he did no evil and he spoke no evil. The Bible says that nothing evil came out of his mouth. Even though people were whipping him, even though people were beating on him and spitting in his face and slapping him and things piercing into his back and ripping his flesh off, thorns going into his skull as they placed the crown of thorns on his head. You talk about having a bad day. He had a bad week. He was constantly running for his life. From the time he was 30 years old until his death at 33 and a half years old, he was running for his life from the Pharisees that were trying to kill him, the Sadducees, they were trying to stone him, People were always trying to trip him up, always trying to catch Jesus doing something wrong, always trying to ask a question, surely he'll mess this up. And even though people would abuse him, turn their back on him, he spoke no evil, and neither did any evil to any man. The last couple of days of his life was the greatest trial that anyone could go through. If you knew ahead of time what Jesus was going through, how many of us could say, I'm still going through with this? I don't think so. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was praying in the garden, not my will, but your be done. Let this cup pass from me, but if not, your will be done. He knew what he was about to endure, but yet he still did it anyway. He knew he was about to go through the greatest trial of his life. Now realize, Jesus didn't deserve it. He did not deserve the beating. He did not deserve the mockery. He did not deserve getting slapped in the face. He did not deserve his back to be ripped apart. He did not deserve to be hanging on that cross, have nails through his hands and his feet. He did not deserve the death of asphyxiation. He couldn't breathe. He would have to fight gravity if his shoulders would become dislocated as he was hanging on the cross trying to breathe, and his guts would begin to spill out and all sorts of things. He didn't deserve it. He didn't deserve any of it. He didn't have to go through it, and he shouldn't have gone through with it. But his trial that he went through, as he calls it, his cup, his trial was nothing, had nothing to do with him, but had everything to do with you. The trial that he went through on those couple of days had nothing to do with Jesus. He didn't deserve it. He didn't do anything wrong. It wasn't like God was lashing out judgment on him. He didn't do anything wrong. He didn't deserve it. But why did he go through with it? Why did he have to do it? Because he saw a couple thousand years down the road, he saw your face, and he said, I've got to go through the trial. Why do I? He's asking in the garden, essentially, why do I have to go through this, God? And I believe, it doesn't say this in the Bible, but this is just me. This is my gospel according to Nick for a moment. Is while he was praying in the garden, that faces just started to flash before his eyes. While he was praying in the garden, let this cup pass from me, and maybe, just maybe, my face flashed before his eyes. He said, you know what? November 24th, 1983, Nick Cacico is going to be born into this world, and he needs you. You're going to go through this for him. Because he's going to be born into sin and shaped in iniquity. He's going to not know what to do. And if you don't die, there's going to be no hope. If you don't endure this trial, there's going to be no hope for him. And so maybe, just maybe, my face flashed before his eyes just for a moment. And he said, you know what? I looked down on the face of time. And I said, you know what? I love him. And I believe maybe your face flashed before his eyes. And your family's faces. And your neighbors. And your co-workers. And they flashed before his eyes. And he said, I know why I've got to go through this. He didn't deserve it. He didn't do anything wrong. And Jesus may have asked why. And he did it because he loves you. And he did it because he loves me. Why do you go through the trial? He did it for one purpose, and that was to save you and this entire world. Would you stand with me here tonight? So the trial that you're in right now, how many people are going through a trial? Anybody? The trial that you're in right now possibly could be that you've done something wrong. I don't necessarily believe that. I believe that the why of your trial, some here tonight, the why, nothing to do with you, Brother Cameron. It's got everything to do with a soul that he's trying to save. Somebody that he's trying to get their attention to let them know there is a God that's more powerful. There is a God who loves them. There is a God who wants to reach out for them. There is a God who wants to see them repent and be baptized and filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. There is a God who loves them enough and trusts you enough to put you in the midst of your trial, to put you in the midst of despair, to put you in pain, and to put you in agony. He didn't. He doesn't. The Bible says that it pleased God to smite Jesus. It pleased God. Wasn't that he was happy that he was doing that, because God knew on the other side of the trial was victory. He knew without the shedding of blood there would be no remission. But he said, if I afflict him, if he goes through the trial, there's going to open the gates of heaven one more time, and they're going to have access to my spirit when they have not had access to my spirit before. They could only go through the priest, but he said, I want to give them access to my spirit. I want to live in their minds, in their hearts, in their bodies. I don't want them to have to go to the priest and pray for their sins. I want them to pray. I want them to be comforted. So yes, Jesus, you've got to go through the trial. Yes, Jesus, you're going to be betrayed. Yes, you're going to get whipped. And yes, you're going to feel bad. And yes, people are going to betray you. And yes, they're going to mock you and spit on you. But it's because I'm trying to win a lost and a dying world. Would you lift your hands with me in this place? Hallelujah, God. I feel your spirit in this house. He told us, shut up. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. If you're going through a trial, I want you to step out of your pew and begin to come up front to this altar. If you're going through a trial in your life, you may have thought right now, you may have thought that, what have I done, God? Why am I going through this? And maybe through this message, hopefully through the message tonight, the teaching of the Word of God, to understand that maybe it's not about you, but I want to willingly lay myself on that altar. I want to willingly come before God and say, God, I'm going to go through the trial if it's to save one. If it's to save one person, God, I'm going to be willing to go through the trial, the financial hardship, the spiritual hardship, the dryness, the barrenness, people rejecting me, speaking evil about me. I'm going to go through it. Would you take a step out of your pew? Would you come to this altar tonight? And would you come and lift your hands in this place? Would you come and lift your hands and let God begin to bless you? Would you come and pour yourself out to God tonight and say, God, now I understand. I understand. I've got to go through this so they can see your miraculous power. I've got to go through this so that they know, my family knows, my friends know, my loved ones know that you're a healer, that you're a deliverer, that you are going to set me free. Would you lift your hands and begin to pray as Brother Spike sings tonight? Would you lift your hands and begin to see the face of God and let God begin to reveal to you why?